Good morning to everybody. We got here. Grace greater than our sin, with amazing grace, was our song this morning. And it was beautiful. Thank you. The announcements for today are the school supply drive. It's going on, and donations can be brought here until August the 6th. And the flyers and information for what we need are on the back. I will tell you, going to get school supplies right now is like finding chicken eggs in a someplace else. You just they're hard to find, so keep looking. Our coffee socials will not be held in July and August, but will resume in September. Are there any joys or concerns?
Yes, I'd like to update on Alice Stambaugh. As you all know, she's at Washington Hospital Center, and she is recuperating pretty well. It's slow and steady, but she is recuperating from her surgery. So it'll be a slow process, so keep Alice in your prayers.
And Judy and Catherine also, I mean Catherine Ann, they need your prayers too. Please join me now in the call to worship. God of light and love, help us this day to worship you with all our hearts, minds, and bodies. Shower us with the grace of your Spirit that we may joyfully receive the message you have for us today. Amen. Please join me now in hymn of praise number 547, The Church is One Foundation.
Thank you. each of you this morning. Let us have our call to confession. With humility and honesty, let us confess our sins to our God, who is slow to anger and quick to forgive. Gracious Creator, we seek your blessings, knowing that we have not entered yet. We seek your blessings. In our sins, we seek your forgiveness. In our weakness, we seek your strength. In our sorrow, we seek your consolation. In our trials, we seek your justice. In our pain, we seek your peace. Hear our prayers, O God, and make our hearts new. Amen. Beloved sisters and brothers in Christ, God has heard our plea for forgiveness and offers us mercy and abundant supply. Our sins have been forgiven. Amen. Let us share together today with the reading of our morning scriptures, 1 Kings chapter 17 and Psalms 147. After this, the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, became ill. And his illness was so severe that there was no breath left in him. And she said to Elijah, "What have you against me, O man of God? You have come to me to bring my sin to remembrance and to cause the death of my son." And he said to her, "Give me your son." And he took him from her arms and carried him up into the upper chamber where he lodged, and laid him on his own bed. And he cried out to the Lord, "O Lord my God, have you brought calamity even upon this widow with whom I sojourned by killing her son?" Then he stretched himself upon the child three times and cried out to Jehovah, "O Lord my God, let this child's life come back into him again." And the Lord listened to the voice of Elijah, and the life of the child came back into him again, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down from the upper chamber into the house and delivered him to his mother. And Elijah said, "See, your son lives." And the Lord said to Elijah, "Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord is in your mouth is truth." Psalms. "He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. He will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. Because you made the Lord your dwelling place, the Most High, who is my refuge, no evil shall be allowed to befall you, no plague shall come near your tent. For he who commands his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways, on their hands they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone." In our lesson today, I want to talk about flags for just a bit and start off talking about football. My research tells me that football has three different flags, a yellow one, a blue one, and a red one. And the yellow one is thrown down to declare a penalty. And there are some reactions from that to the team. The blue one is to let folks know there is a loose ball on the middle of the field. And I don't know a whole lot about football, but I found that interesting. Because I think a lot of times in our lives, there are loose balls that give us some problems. That's a good way to trip down and injure yourself, isn't it? Thirdly, there's a red flag, which is a challenge flag used by the coach. for some mistake or for some correction in playing the game. Have you ever felt like God is throwing you a flag? I expect if all of us were honest, we would say absolutely. Because God is good at reprimanding us and teaching us and trying to urgently guide us in the right path. And we're like sheep. It's often that you and I stray and God has to whip us and bring us back into line and submission to Him. In this lesson today, this widow faces a very real crisis. Her son dies, and she is ready to throw both God and the prophet a red flag because of this crisis. Yet the widow has a lot with which to be grateful and to be thankful. God has sustained her and her son for many for a long time, has taken care of them, and God is going to continue that into the future. All of us face crises from time to time, and often when we are facing a crisis, as in this nature in this story, the widow's son suddenly dies, and she is faced with an end-of-life crisis. And she has a crisis there, and the prophet comes to her rescue. And how often in life do we, with our finances, our children, and whatever else comes to us, we are constantly dealing with situations in life that challenge us, to which we seek for and long for answers to those particular situation. The widow says in verse 18 to the prophet, "What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" I'm sure all of us can relate to her statement, because all of us from time to time has faced crises in our families, with our children, with our finances, and with health and health challenges. And life is always throwing us a curve. And we have to intercept that, make the best of it at times, and then move on with life. You'll see, observe now that yesterday God saves. But today there appears to be a very powerless crisis that this woman has no ability to deal with. Suddenly she discovers that her son, her only son, has died. And the prophet has been staying with her in the little upper room on the top of her house. And she is in great grief. And in somewhat of a sense, she attacks, she comes to the prophet and wants to know what is going on, that her son is suddenly taken sick and died, and why is God judging her and bringing crisis into her life? You see, many times yesterday we had victories. We go through those times with joy and smiles on our face. But church, I want to tell you, there are always times. There are days when trials come our way, when we feel the same crisis that this woman feels, and we wonder where to turn and what to do. And we have to cry out to God, look to others for guidance, and trust God that He will save us from the crisis that we are facing in that very hour. This widow asks for blessings and feels like she got a curse. She asked for God's goodness, God's blessings. The prophet of God came and prayed over her and her son and her house. And yet she feels like what she got in return was a curse, the death of her son. Folks, we face all kinds of crises in life. On our job, we can't wait to get it. We hear it. We think it's the best thing on this side of heaven, and we get in there and start working, and we find out there's a whole lot of stuff that ain't going right. And then we have to learn to adjust. We have great anticipations of marriage and having families, and we get married, and then we are facing at times with crisis, with decisions that have to be made. And in this particular case, she is dealing with the sudden death of her son. And we feel with many of those kinds of crises and have to seek the face of God to try to find answers to those crises. We need healing at times. We go along with health and strength, and everything's going going good, and then all of a sudden we're in my boat. My daughter and I will be seeing a surgeon on Friday, and because that hurts. That's all I can do with it, folks. I don't have any use of this arm, and I hope when he gets through with it, that we'll be able to. Things will be a whole lot different. But we're constantly in life facing challenges. Sometimes we don't know what to do and where to do. To be honest with you, I think the most devastating, difficult challenge that I ever faced was the sudden death of my dear wife, Mary. And it was totally unexpected, happened in less than 12 hours, and I was just out of it. What do I do? Where do we go? What happens? It was a very, very tough time in life. And yet, God found me in my deep sorrow, and he sent others my way to undergird me, and we got through that. And really, because of that is why I am in Frederick and ultimately became your pastor. And to be honest, I was not doing well. And my daughter said, Daddy, you need to come on up here. So we packed it and came up here, and it's been a wonderful time and much better adjustment. But I'm telling you, life is filled with those challenges and those crises. And some way we have to tie a knot in the end of our ropes. We have to hold on to it for dear life and cry out to God to come to our rescue and undergird us, strengthen us, give us new guidance, new motivation, so that we can walk with him. You see, God wants us to be living not in the natural, but in the supernatural. All of us live part of our lives in the natural because we are born flesh and blood human beings. We have to pay our bills. We have to gather food. We have to cook. We have to eat. We've got to clean. We go through all of these normal weekly, daily chores. It's a part of life that we have to engage. And yet in the middle of all of that, God meets us. He encourages us. He teaches us. He lifts us up. And this particular story, we have a widow with a young son, probably 10-ish to early teens, and suddenly the prophet comes and stays in her extra room up on top of the house. If you've ever seen pictures of Old Testament times, people would build their little house, and then they had narrow, if you ever seen them, they're scary. They look like narrow steps about so wide going up the outside of the house with no railing. And it's on that house they have a spare room as a room. And so the prophet is staying in this upper room while he is being refreshed and to bless the widow and her son. And yet the son gets sick suddenly and dies. And the widow says to him, what do I have to do with you? You have come my way. It has brought me a curse. My son has died. We are in a crisis. And she says to him, and I'm quoting, your godliness reminds me of my sins, and my life is ruined. And here she is reaching out, seeking for comfort, seeking to find undergirding strength, to find forgiveness for what she is experiencing and for the pain and the crisis that life has brought her way. She is walking in the midst of conflicting circumstances. Often, church, I want you to know that things happen in our lives and our circumstances begin to control our lives, our emotions, our decision-making. And it brings grief and sorrow, and sometimes it brings exhilarating happiness and fun times. Life is a constant seesaw. We don't get it good all the time, neither do we get the bad all the time. But we have to learn in this seesaw of up and down crises in life. And I ask today, what controls our theology? We've got two choices. Look at this story. What two choices do we see here? First of all, there are circumstances. Excuse me. There are some challenging circumstances because this young lad, probably as a older adolescent or young teenager, he suddenly becomes sick and he dies. And in this crisis, it touches both the life of Elijah and the life of this widow. And he says to her, "Give me your son." And she lifts up her son, and he carries him up into his upper room. Now, it's quite interesting what actions he takes. The Word of God tells us that he took the young lad up, laid him on his bed, and then Elijah stretched himself over the top of this young man three times. It's interesting to study commentators on this particular part of this story, because a number of commentators would tell you that Elijah was giving him a mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, trying to bring him back. Others would tell you that he is entered in intercessory prayer. I don't know what he's doing. All the thing the Bible says, he took the child up to his room and he stretched himself eyeball to eyeball, body to body, over that son. Some commentators will say the child was starting to grow cold and he's trying to warm him up. I don't know what he's doing. But I believe part of what he is doing is interceding with God for this child and for her, for the woman. And suddenly we are told that God gives breath back to this child. God resuscitates him and he begins to live. And Elijah is both grateful and thankful, and he takes him back down into the house to his mother. Now, Elijah has cried out to God, intercessory prayer over this child for God, and God listened to him. He heard his prayer, and he restores the young man. What do we do, church, when we're in crises? That's a big question. And sometimes we have very terrible things that we have to deal with in life. Whether it's sickness, probably the most challenging thing I have ever dealt with was in less than 12 hours, my wife, Mary, died. Totally unexpected. And I rushed her to, matter of fact, I was at work when she called me. And I jumped in the car and headed home, called her sister. And they got an ambulance, sent her to the hospital, and she lived 12 hours. That was a devastating day, and it was very, very difficult. But I would tell you that God was with me, and others were there to strengthen and to comfort me. But I want to ask you today, church, what do we do when God, in his mercy and wisdom, allows crises to come into our lives? We have to face it. We have to deal with it. We may not have any answers to it or for it. We may have more questions than anything else and wonder where God is and what God is doing. How could God see good out of this in His wisdom? We don't know those things, but what we do know, church, is God. And Elijah cried out to God for this widowed woman and for her son. And in his intercession, he touched God. And in this case, God, in his divine grace and mercy, touched this young man and gave him life and gave him a second chance, which brought joy and grace and I'm sure excitement to his mother. You see, I ask the question, when we're in the middle of crisis, when all of a sudden life has done a U-turn on us and we're facing surgery or facing sickness or facing death or facing crisis, what do we do, church? We have to turn to and run to God. Look at Moses as an example. In Exodus chapter 32, the children of Israel began to worship a golden calf, and God sent judgment upon them because of their evil and wickedness in worshiping that. And Moses began to intercede for the children of Israel, and God, in his loving kindness and mercy, forgave them, restored them, healed them. And God again led his nation in victory. And church, I want to tell you, we all face those crises. I think we have made progress in this church. You have been very faithful to be a part of it and to support it. And it is my deep conviction that God wants to empower us and enable us to better grow this church. I've been praying for God to give us growth, for God to touch people in our communities, in our lives, in our families. And I would like to challenge you today. Begin to join with me in intercession with God that He will bless Thurmont, that He will bring men and women and children into our church. I would love to see us have people so that we could start Sunday school again. And even have a good children's program. Folks, that's what we need to touch this city. And I challenge you today to join me in intercessory prayer. Let us ask God, God, what do you want me to do? How can I affect a change in Thurmont? That it will begin to grow and that lives will be touched and challenged. And that we might have a direct impact upon the city of Thurmont. You see, Elijah takes this young boy that he has prayed over and brings him and says, look, your son is alive. That's what I want to see when you and I can see God beginning to work in Thurmont. We can pray for a resurrection. We can pray for God's divine anointing. We can pray for God to touch men and women and boys and girls and bring them into this church. We can ask God, can't talk when your throat gets dry, it's fine. But folks, we can begin to ask God, God, who do you want me to be praying about? Which one of my family members are my neighbors? And we can start interceding with God, church, for individuals in this city, in our families that we know that are unchurched. And pray until God moves in their hearts and their lives. And we begin to see church growth here in Thurmont. If you believe that is possible, give me a hearty amen. But it will not happen, church, unless we are God's mouthpiece. We are God's hands. We are God's blessing and anointing. And we have to touch people for God to move in their hearts and lives. We touch them, first of all, in our prayer closets and praying over men and women and boys and girls. We touch them when we visit with them or see them in the grocery store and chat with them. Or visiting their homes and tell them we miss them. We're looking for you. We want you. Folks, unless we get busy, folks are not going to be drawn. Let me tell you, we look around in this church. Look at yourself and your neighbors around you. We are the magnets. And when God anoints us with his goodness and mercy, we can draw other individuals into this house and into this church, and we can see it grow. I believe that. And I wanted to challenge you today. What did the widow say once the prophet prayed over her son and God resurrected him from his death? She says, "Now I know that you are a true man of God, and God is with you." You see, she saw God at work in her home. She saw, I started to say, the devil at work. I don't think devil takes our lives, but so I wouldn't correct that. But she saw her son die. She laid him in his bed. She touched him when he was cold, and her heart was broken. And yet God interceded to bring life into her son. And I believe that God wants to work through us in this community, in your home, in your family, with your neighbors, that God wants to work through us as he did Elijah, and to bring spiritual life into the souls and the minds and the lives of men and women. So you and I have got to be the instruments of life, the instruments of the grace and the power of God. And I challenge you today, find somewhere, get alone in your bedroom or somewhere in your house and talk to God. Ask God to burden and bless our hearts for the lives of men and women that he wants to give life to, that we might intercede and pray for them. That we might ask God to have them to interject themselves across our lives, that we might speak to them and encourage them and invite them. And folks, when we begin to do that in a consistent manner, I tell you, God will bless us and God will bring growth to this church. If you believe I'm telling the truth, give me a good amen. But it's up to us, church. We are the steady people here. We are the faithful people here. And it is our job, as it was Elijah's, to pray over this son, that we might pray over death, spiritual death, wherever we see it, around us and in our lives, that by our intercession, God Almighty will bring spiritual life into the hearts, the minds, and the lives of men and women and boys and girls in our homes, in our communities, and in our lives. May God Almighty call us, set us apart, put a burden and a desire in our spirits, in our hearts, that we will begin daily to intercede for this church, that we will begin daily to pray for the lives, the hearts, and the minds of men and women and boys and girls, that God will move in their lives, in their hearts, in their minds, and that we will be ready as God speaks and calls us, that we might put our arms around them and love them and encourage them to commit themselves to the living God. May God empower us, may God anoint us, and may God enable Fairmont to grow in the coming weeks and months. Amen.
Thank you.
and strength that you have given us, for financial provisions that you have blessed us with, so that we are able to care for and minister to our families and others who are in need. We ask that you will bless the offerings that we have given to you. I ask that you will multiply them, O God, to meet every need of this church, and that you will also anoint us as leaders and as board members, that we might have the wisdom to see and know how to spend what you have given us for the upbuilding of your church and for the salvation of souls. In Christ's name, amen.
Let us sing together our doxology. Okay. Father, we just thank you so much today for your wonderful goodness and grace to us. We thank you, O God, that in your loving kindness you have given us such a wonderful and lovely place to gather together, to sense your spirit, to hear your word, to worship you, O God, in spirit and in truth. And I ask you today that you will fill each one of our hearts with your grace, with your peace, with your spirit, with your power. O God, that you will anoint us to walk in your ways, to be obedient to you, that will bring honor and glory to you. I pray, O God, that you will lay the souls and minds of our sons and daughters and our neighbors and our friends upon our hearts. O God, that we will become an intercessor that will cry out to you. And spare not, O God, for the salvation of men and women and boys and girls, that you will begin to convict their hearts, that you will draw them by your Holy Spirit and put a yearning and a desire within them, O God, to love you and to serve you, to come and to be in your house and to hear your word and to grow thereby. Father, we just pray that you will place it upon each of our hearts today, the minds and the souls of men, women, boys, and girls, that you would have us, first of all, to intercede over and to pray over. That you will send your Holy Spirit to convict and call them, O God, and draw them to yourself and to this church. We ask that as you so choose, that you will put it within our minds, our thoughts, our hearts, O God, to invite others, to talk to them, and to urge them to come and to be with us to worship you. Father, we are asking that you will begin to give us growth in this church, that you will move in our own hearts and our lives, that we will seek your face more earnestly daily than we have in the past, that you will put a burden and a concern upon our hearts for the souls and the lives of our sons and daughters and granddaughters and grandsons, for our neighbors and our friends, and that as we intercede with you, that you will move in the hearts and lives of other individuals and men and women, that you will draw them into your house, that your word, O God, will touch their hearts and their minds and will convict them, O God, and give them a yearning inside of their very spirits to know you, to give their lives to you, to walk in your ways, that you, O God, will give us growth, that your kingdom, O God, will grow and that souls will be blessed and anointed and brought to you. Father, we just give this place and this church to you today. It is your house. It is not ours. And we just ask you to multiply your grace, your goodness to each of us, to our family members and to our neighbors, that you might bless them in your grace and your glory. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Now will you stand with me, please, and turn to 442, and let us share in our closing hymn.
ask today that you will dismiss us in your love, your goodness, and your grace. I ask that you will send us out of this building into the harvest and lay upon our mind and our spirits the souls and the lives of our families, our neighbors, that as we intercede with you, that you will begin to give us new people in our church. Go with us, protect us, guide us, O God, with your tender, loving care. In Christ's name, amen.